In this video, we will be reviewing Unit 6, which includes groups, step events, and motion. Sometimes when you're programming and you end up creating a lot of shapes for your picture on the canvas, it's useful to group some of them together. Grouping is just taking a collection of shapes and treating them as one. And to do that, you can use the call to group, where you take group, open parentheses, and input all of the shapes you want to be held into the group. This could be helpful for, say, if you are drawing a forest and you have one shape that you can call a tree rather than having to constantly redraw all the parts of the tree. And the group also has properties which can be modified. You can modify its position, opacity, fill, width, height, so pretty much like any other shape. In addition, every single shape within a group is considered its child, and each shape also has its own properties. If the shape doesn't have a name, it's really, really difficult to individually modify the shape. So if you know in advance that a shape will be modified, make sure to name it. Then you can call it, and then its properties can be modified individually without affecting the rest of the group. Just like for regular shapes, there also exists group methods, which includes all the previous methods we discussed for shapes. So to front, to back, hits shape, contains, etc. All of these work for the entire group. But there's also some group-specific methods to keep in mind. So if you would like to add a shape to a group after its creation, you can do group name dot add and insert the shape. You can also clear the entire group by using dot clear, or you can remove a specific shape by using group dot remove shape. And make note that all shapes that are not put into a group that you have made are automatically put into app group. So if you want to say if you're designing a whiteboard app and you want the ability to delete everything on the canvas that you've drawn, you might want to use app.group.clear. An exciting new built-in function we learned about is onStep, which allows for the app to change without the user's input. It'll be called repeatedly after a certain amount of time, which is known as a step. And if you want the steps to be more often or less often, you can modify them by using app.stepsperSecond. This function can be used to animate objects by having them move in a direction or diagonal by using CenterX and CenterY for every single step. We can also implement custom properties like .dx or .dy, which would represent the change in x or y variables. And always keep in mind that when you're modifying dx, dy, or CenterX, CenterY, to use addition, since subtraction can be represented by using addition with negatives. So here's a quick demonstration of the power of onStep. So here in this code, we have defined a dot with a plum color. It has a horizontal movement of 2, so dot dot dx equals 2. We have some labels just to clarify what the code is doing. And onStep, we're going to have the dot move in a certain direction by 2. And with key press, we can actually control some of this. So if we click S, we're going to switch the direction of the dot by multiplying its dx by -1. By clicking D, we can speed up the steps. And by clicking A, we can slow them down. So let's go to the canvas and take a look at what that looks like. So here's our dot. If I hit S, it switches directions. Nice. If we hit D, it starts moving faster. Get it back on screen, and if we hit A, I can slow it to a stop. So clearly this is a very powerful tool, and it's starting to look like we can animate some of the shapes that we've been working with before. Now that we have step events and can make it look like our object is animated, there's a few extra special motion types that we can learn about. The first of which is reversing, in which you change the sign of dx or dy by multiplying by -1, which we just saw in the previous demo. We also have standing still, in which the values of dx or dy are 0. Bounded motion, which ensures that the shape does not move beyond a certain point. Wraparound, where the shape moves from one edge of the canvas to the other. Bouncing, which is when a shape reaches a boundary, it reverses directions. And finally, smooth motion, which involves balancing the values of dx or dy with app steps per second. Let's take a look at some demos to get a better idea of what this specialized motion looks like in code. So this first one is bounded motion. We have a dot defined at the top, And we have its horizontal motion defined as dot dx equals 4. And on step, if the rightmost point of the dot is less than 400, we're going to let it move horizontally. So we're testing this by going to the center and adding the radius and checking if it's less than 400 to make sure it doesn't go outside the canvas. So let's take a look at what that looks like on the canvas. There we go, the circle is moving, but then as soon as its rightmost point hits the canvas, it stops. With wraparound, we're going to define another dot, name it C, and give it a horizontal motion of 5. Then on step, we're going to move the dot by its horizontal motion. And whenever its leftmost side exits the canvas completely, we're going to set its right side to 0. So it pretty much looks like it's wrapping around the canvas. So let's take a look at that. So here's the dot moving. And once it fully exits the canvas on this side, it pops in on this side. For bouncing motion, once again, we have a circle defined with a horizontal motion. And we're going to move it to the right or left with every single step. We also check if the rightmost point on the circle is greater than 400, which is the rightmost edge of the canvas, or the leftmost point on the circle is farther than the leftmost point on the canvas, we switch the direction. So let's take a look. Here it goes. It hits the right side of the canvas and switches directions on both sides. Thanks for tuning in. We hope that this video helped you in your review of Unit 6. Make sure to check out all of our review materials online, as well as our class notes at the CS Academy website.